What's going on, guys? You know who it is, DJ Woo Pig, also known as John Simmons, my given name, which none of you know me by. But anyway, today is a very special day on the channel. We're actually gonna start a new segment. I'm gonna call it Showtime. I don't wanna call it a podcast because it probably won't come out on a regular basis, but it's gonna be about an hour long show with people who are in the entertainment industry. It may be sound engineers or lighting designers or staging people. It's really just a show for people in the entertainment business, whether it be DJ entertainment or large scale entertainment, one of the two. And it's called Showtime, and I'm super excited about it. You know, it's going to be something that I expect you guys to just kind of put on and listen to in the background, whether when you're working out or doing whatever. It hasn't happened yet, but I do plan on uploading the audio versions to wherever you're getting your audio. So whether it's Apple Music or Spotify or whatever, that's where I plan on uploading the audio only version. But the video version will of course be right here on the YouTube channel. That's it. Coronavirus it seems like it's almost done. We don't know that yet. Things are slowly starting to open back up, so I hope all of you guys are getting back to work very soon. It's been a struggle here to find things to do and stay motivated when there's just so many uncertainties. So I am super glad that we are getting back to work, because I don't know that I've caught like a wind of depression, but it's like, seeing your business just kind of struggle sucks. And I think 2020 was supposed to be the year for everyone. So I'm glad to be getting back to work. Hopefully, like I said, you guys are getting back to work as well. And I've got a baby coming up in like a couple weeks now. It's kind of exciting. So again, this is a new segment called Showtime. I'm super pumped about it. I think it's gonna do well. And I look forward to having more guests on the show to talk all things entertainment whenever the time may come. But anyway, today's guest, I actually met him while I was working as a stage manager at Hills Alive. It's a huge, one of the largest Christian music festivals in the nation, and this guy just so happened to watch my videos on YouTube, and we sparked conversation, and here we are now. So without further ado, the first episode features a buddy of mine named Kale Conrad. I hope you enjoy. Take care. It's showtime. What's going on, guys? You know who it is, DJ Woo Pig, alongside one of, I guess I can just call him a friend. I met him randomly at a concert in South Dakota, but do want to welcome to the Zoom conference, Mr. Kale Conrad, originally from St. Louis, now living in Nashville. Kale, tell us a little bit about yourself, and I guess part of your background and kind of how we met, and we'll just go from there.
Definitely. Thanks for having me. This is pretty great. I didn't realize it was in South Dakota that we met.
South Dakota, yeah, of all places.
Man. Originally from St. Louis. I've been in Tennessee, I guess, proper for 5 or 6 years. Kind of moved around a little bit. But I've been a musician my whole life, drummer predominantly. And so I've done some, been in bands and producing and stuff like that. But I took kind of like some notes from a friend of mine who is an audio engineer and a just brilliant guy. His name's Justin. And he just was like, he was leaving the church he was at or something like that. And they were like, hey, does anybody want to learn what he does? Because, we're going to need help. And I was like, oh, I'd love to learn. I've been around music. And, sure. And he was also a good friend. And so, but he kind of took me under his wing and kind of just like slowly but surely taught me. The first console I ever touched was a Yamaha LS9. Ooh, and yeah,
the dinosaur.
Yeah,
the dinosaur.
For real. Yeah. And so so got into it like that real slowly. And what happened was that I kind of just really, I fell in love with it for some reason. And so like I kind of just went home and like Google and YouTube and everything I could about like audio and live mixing and stuff like that. And so as I slowly was like, I was at a church and I was kind of serving there for a while and kind of was just watching and observing and became friends with some people and like got to touch an X32 like back in, I think this is 2012, 2013.
Oh yeah, so X32 was so
yeah. Yeah, it was popping. And so it was kind of my first go at it. And because I was like, I was helping people, I think I just was like even more enthralled with learning everything I could about it. And so, and applying it and doing what I could. And so I just kind of went off the rails and was like researching everything. And that's kind of how I got my start in like the audio world, still being a musician, still playing with the bands and stuff like that. But did that. And I went to college for a year and then I was like, no, I don't think I don't know what I want to do. So jumped out of that and kind of just, I got into audio, was around friends and kind of like people caught wind of it. That's when I started kind of recording through DAWs and stuff like that. And got like Logic and all kinds of stuff. And so it really just kind of took off from there. And yeah. I got asked to do more and more things and kind of, you know, and always am learning. But and then I had to kind of balance playing and doing like audio gigs and started doing weddings and DJing and stuff like that. And so I started doing all that stuff, and which was fun because like at that time in my 20s, like everybody's getting married and all my friends are getting married and they're like, hey, would you want to like MC and DJ our wedding? I was like, you know what, why not, like let's do it. And so started doing that and I moved to Jackson, Tennessee, which is just outside of Memphis, and I started working for a church and was a technical director there and just kind of was there for 4 or 5 years, but learned a ton of stuff there and always still am, but got kind of the thing started going where I would take my vacations, I'd be, you know, out with bands or I'd be doing events or weddings or whatever. And so I'd make some side cash. And then, eventually, I guess a year or so ago, I moved to Memphis, just kind of from some relationships I had, and then started working with a guy out of Florence, Alabama. His company is called Overflow Productions. Tim Spidell is his name, but brilliant guy, super fun. He's been in the touring world for a long time. So started working with him kind of freelancing, and that's kind of like where I kind of made the jump into freelancing full time like a year and a half or two, almost 2 years ago. But I've been, you know, kind of on the side, had been here and there jumping into it. So I'd done it. And my older stepbrother is a professional musician, has been touring for years, most of my life. And so I got to go out with him years ago, get a taste for it. And, kind of right when I started, but yeah, moved to Memphis. And then kind of a couple months into that, I got a phone call from a band and was like, what? Like, this is nuts. Like, it was kind of the first, and it was because of this relationship I had with this guy in Florence with that production company. Nice. The guy, their production manager for this band knew him and was like, hey, if he vouches for you, then you're probably exactly what we're looking for. And like that week, and I had been looking on a website called bobnet.rock. So if anybody wants to get in the touring world, like that's a great resource. It's huge. It's got, I mean, it's worldwide. So it's called bobnet.rocks. It's the weirdest name, but it's like a massive group, and you have to like, it's pretty exclusive. You have to like submit your resume. There's two pools. There's Young Guns, so it's 3 years and less. And then there's Pros. And there's and that's like 10 years or more, I don't know, something like that. And but you have to like submit a resume. They have to a guy named Bob, he has to like approve it, and then, you know, like it's a whole thing. You pay like $25 a year. Okay. But it's honestly like worth it if you're trying to do it, because people get gigs off there all the time. And that's actually how I got my first gig, was through bobnet.rocks. And so I, you know, submitted a resume, you know, in December or whatever, and it'd been a few months, but, did that and got, you know, had a few. I didn't really have very many like references that were worth it. And it's, you know, because I like, I knew some people, but it wasn't like, you know, it's like my friend Dave, like they're not going to know who that is. Right. And so, but got in with that, and the Facebook group is amazing. But yeah, I got this call and went and met with their tour manager, and he was like, and I told him, I said, man, this is the biggest gig I've ever done. So just to be fair and like wanted to be honest, like I'm up to the task, but there's going to be a learning curve. And I just wanted to be totally honest because like, I didn't want to burn myself. I didn't want to burn the band. Like I, you know, so I wanted him to be able to make the decision like, okay, maybe we need somebody else.
And that's the best way to do it, because I feel like, you know, a lot of the people that may watch this, and I try to be as honest as possible, you know, when talking on the internet. But the best way to do something is just to be upfront and honest. Look, I don't have, you know, 10 years of experience. I'm not a road dog. I'm not a pirate. You know, I'm fairly new to this. But hey, if you give me a chance, I'm going to work hard and I'm going to do everything I can to try to make everybody else look good. So that's awesome that you were upfront about your experience, for sure.
Yeah. And that was kind of my like policy on it. I knew that like if there was that piece in me that was like, I could kind of like BS my way through this and like really make myself look good. But I was like, you know what? The longevity and like the negative connotation that would have would be so much worse than the right here and now. And like, if I showed up and like overpromised and under delivered, I wanted to do the opposite of that.
Right.
And then even in that, the conversation, at least I would have had like a contact in the industry that would have been like, you know what, we had a meeting and he's a great guy and I think he'd be perfect for this group. And so like if that name was on my resume, they would know like he was super honest with us, like we didn't pick him up, but that's just because of the, you know, size of the gig or whatever.
Yeah.
And so that's why I did it, because I was just like, you know what, it's not like I can't really control stuff I can't control, so I'm gonna just be honest and see what happens. And so I got the gig, funny enough, like I think he called or texted me or emailed me like 2 days later and was like, or maybe he was on the spot, but he was like, we're going to do a 90 day like trial kind of thing. If you want to do it that way. And then we'll just like reassess from there. And so I did my, you know, first gig with them. They flew me out in North Carolina. And
is this a band that other people would know?
I mean, it's the one I met you with. So
really?
Yeah. That was like my very first gig.
Are we allowed to say?
Yeah, I know, right? I don't see why not. I don't know if it was a band called For King and Country.
All right, so
it was my very first gig.
For King.
That was my background, basically.
Right. My goodness, I didn't realize that was like the first. That was the first show. That's crazy, because.
The show that I met you at wasn't the first show, but that was the first band.
That was the first band. Okay.
Because when was that? That was like midsummer.
July. Yeah, that was July.
Okay, so I started with them end of March.
Okay, very cool.
Beginning of April, kind of end of that. So.
Wow. So.
Well, yeah, something like that. Anyway.
For those of you who don't know who King and Country is, or don't follow contemporary Christian music, they're probably one of the top names in the game right now when it comes to contemporary Christian music. You got your Bethels, you got your Elevation Worships, and then you got people like For King and Country or Big Daddy Weave. Like they're a huge group. So for you to get a job, you know, your first job working with those guys, tell me about that experience. That's got to be pretty exciting, right?
Oh, God. Man, it was wild. The thing was about it is because I don't even really follow that music. Like, it's not that I, like, don't know it, but I don't really follow
it.
I'm the same.
Yeah.
And I had, like, heard of them, but I didn't really understand the scale in which they worked. And then I started, like, researching. Because, like, when I reached out, you know, you submit – when people are looking for a gig, you get an email from BobNet, and then you, like, send your resume and whatever. And they don't necessarily tell you all the time, like, who it's with, how much it pays, all this stuff. And, like, they didn't. And so when I got it back, they're like, we're working for this band. And I was like, whoa, that's kind of like a big deal. And, like, so I went and looked, and I was like, yo, what? These guys are massive. For, like, their, like, side of the industry. And I was like, I didn't realize. I mean, 8 people on stage, 64 inputs. Like, I think only 8 of those were tracks. So everything else was, 58
Oh, wow.
Inputs are live, totally live.
My goodness.
So for my position, by the way, because I don't think I said it, was I was a monitor engineer. That was what I went on to do. That's a lot of stuff to work on. Like,
a lot of moving parts. I mean,
for not.
Right.
Yeah. And I'm mostly a front of house guy. And like, but I can, you know, obviously it kind of correlates if you know what you're doing. But it was, man, when I got the gig, I was like reaching out to all my buddies and all the friends that I have. And it was just like, man, it was the wildest thing. Cause I was like, I'm literally, for me at the time, am going to the very top. Like, yeah. I was going instantly to the top, yeah. Because like when I would tell my friends who have been in the industry, they're like, oh, who'd you get a gig with? I said a band called For King and Country. They're like, what? Exactly what you did was like,
so,
yep, that's like,
to put this in perspective, it's if you don't know Christian music, and again, I don't listen to, it's not my primary listen, but to put this in like secular music perspective, that's like your first job is going to be a monitor engineer for Bruno Mars.
Yeah, it's something Bruno Mars isn't quite where I put them, but in their
field, for sure.
ECM world is like, they're up there. It's like doing your first gig with a Ed Sheeran or like just somebody met. Like, it, Lauren Daigle was in that side of it. She still is, but like, she used to open for them.
Really? Okay.
And then they've been tight. Like, they, so like that whole crew, we all know each other.
Right.
And so like, it was a massive thing. It was like going to work for Adele or somebody else like that in the CCM world. And the thing is like, you know, regardless of what you think about the music, they're still touring at a high level. Like, they still are doing arenas. Like, so my first touring experience was in arenas and 30,000 people, like person, like festivals. That's like the crazy one that we met at, one that we met at, isn't that like one of the biggest? I don't even know.
So Hills Alive in South Dakota, that's one of the biggest Christian music festivals in the country. And we're talking, you know, 20,000-30,000 people in this little bitty town.
They headline all these and I wasn't even ready for the scope of which, like, and it sounds, I'm never good at this part because like, people are like, oh, who are you working for? And I would be like, For King and Country. And I try not to name drop, but you know, if they ask, it's like, I'm not gonna, you know, have a false humility about it. But I was just like, For King and Country, they're like, dude, that's crazy. I was like, yeah, I know. Like, I'm impressed too. Like, I cannot believe that I'm, one, I got the gig, and two, that I'm still on the gig, like, and you know, whatever. And so, it was just kind of like wild for me because I was like going straight to the top, and I would like in my mind, and like obviously hoping to get other gigs later on that weren't necessarily in the CCM. Not that I would mind, but they were great. And I liked their music and they were great people. The first time meeting everybody was so smooth and so easy. But like, that was like my first real experience with things like tour buses and like Master Tour, which is like a, you know, program that we use to keep everybody on the same schedule, and like, you know, working with a big crew. And like, it was like that. I've seen them before and I was like, oh, that's crazy. Like, at, you know, events that I'd help set up. But like, this was like day to day, week in and week out, just like doing this setup. Like I said, 64 inputs, like the staging, like everything. If you don't know there, just go Google a YouTube, like just, or go Google a YouTube, go YouTube one of their videos.
Right.
That's
it's
like
a lot, it's
one of their
a lot
live
of moving
shows.
Parts.
It's crazy. There's so much going on.
That's one of the things that I was, you know, when we met, our, you know, the company that I was working for, the front of house guy for King and Country, and him, they knew each other. So he said, yeah, he's from Australia, right? The front of house guy.
No, Ralph Rivera is his name. You might be thinking about their lighting guy. Their lighting guy is their one of the brothers.
Okay.
And he's from Australia. Front of house guy is named Ralph. Yeah. The LD.
Okay.
But the front of house guy for them is Ralph Rivera. He's from, Costa Rica?
Okay.
Question mark. So he's originally from Philly, but anyway, he's been out here in Nashville.
Yeah, the crazy part about that is they knew each other, and he's like, I'd never, the contemporary Christian music is like, again, isn't my bag, so I'd never really kind of put two and two together. I thought it was just the same old stuff that you would think that it is. But when you guys, when your truck got there and you started unloading all of this stuff for a contemporary music show, it's like, man, there is a lot of moving parts. Like, and the thing that was crazy about for King & Country is all of the musicians, they all rotated. They all rotate yeah. through stuff. So enough about the band. How was it, you know, if you're mixing 64 inputs, I believe you were on a Digico console, correct?
SD12, yeah.
SD12. So tell us about the experience of you know, being going from a church guy to being on tour with a major act and mixing 64 inputs live. Was there, how long did it take you to get to, you know, where you were comfortable with it?
Well, the thing is about that too, is like, if you're in this inside of the industry, like, you always inherit a file,
right?
Which is like, isn't a bad thing, especially, but that everybody works different.
Yeah.
And so everybody's minds work differently. And so like the way he had it set up wasn't a preference for me. And the other thing was, I had never touched an SD12 console in my life. Never. And I had been on, I know, right? An SD9.
Okay.
An SD10. And maybe another one, but I had never touched the 12. Or I'm sorry, I have touched the 12, but I had never worked on
it for long
enough to like be the guy to go to. And so, and like, 12, I'm still learning stuff about it. But
that's their flagship model, right?
Yeah, okay. The SD12. And I love the console. Like, after I got into the nitty gritty, I was like, okay, this is sick. I like this. Like, I like what it's doing. I don't necessarily like how the GUI looks, because it looks very Windows to me, but right. like, But whatever, like, the console did great work. And so, but I had never messed with it until I started working for them. And so like, I was like going from what I'd come from, which was working on like an SC48, you know, rocking 50 inputs, whatever, from a front of house perspective.
Right.
Like, I, you know, going into a different mindset with monitors, because it's 8 stereo mixes that I'm working on stage. And then if you see their show, because they all, each song, there's 2 drum sets, like, there's all this stuff where like the keys player is, their MD plays keys, cello, bass, guitar, marimba, drums, background sings, like, he does all, and like, and then most of them all do that too. Like, if you watch it, they just all switch. So every song I had to have a different snapshot, so they had different levels. And so it was, you know, listen to the click, and then it was like, da 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 snap, and the snapshot move, like, make sure it was just all like everything. Uh-huh. Had a new, like, some stuff had to be safe and it didn't, and so it was like a ton of moving things, and I didn't even know their music. So that was the hardest part, was like, okay, I don't know when their songs end, they're different than the record, so I had to learn on the fly. Mm-hmm. And so the like, going into it, I called everybody. I was like, working on SD12, where can I look for resources? I need to learn everything I can about it. And like, I had been on Digico stuff, and I had talked to Ralph, their front of house guy, and he felt comfortable with my knowledge. And I had done everything I could to figure out what I could beforehand. And I even got the file ahead of time. And so I like got all the, you know, on the PC kind of like work, or what is it called? The controller and all that stuff, just to like look through the file and understand it more. And so it was a lot of legwork ahead of time. But the bummer was, the guy who was leaving before, he was like out so quick that the first gig I came on was like, I didn't get to shadow anybody. So he was gone already.
Yeah.
And so I was coming on to the first show he wasn't at. It wasn't like, hey, like, come on to like a couple shows, see how he functions, see how he works, kind of implement your own way, but like, figure out what he has first. None of that. Like, I had his phone number, I called him, like, what should I think about, what should I look for? And so it was a lot of legwork, but I mean, it was
now, so going back to the guy being gone that fast, is that something that happens a lot on touring? Is it like, 1 minute you're there, 1 minute you're not? Or and if you can't talk about it, I get it.
Yeah, no, totally.
But is that something that's pretty common for engineers and maybe lighting directors or, you know, designers or whatever? Is it a pretty common place for them to just say, you know what, I'm out? Or is it a proper protocol for leaving a tour?
So what's interesting about this is, like, there are so many different like sides to it. Mm-hmm. There are some people in, you know, that are on a crew for a band that are salaried. There are some that are on retainer. Mm-hmm. Like there's, you know, and then there's a lot of them who are all 1099 contractors. Mm-hmm. And so the way it works a lot of times. So to be fair, he didn't just like leave one day. I did make it sound like that. He told them like months out, but like they still didn't have a setup to where they were like, there was any overlap, and that can be
anywhere,
you know, and that can be whether it's from the management band side or it's from a crew guy that's like, I'm out. But it happens more. It probably happens less than most people think.
Okay.
And what's the other side of that? And more than, I don't know how to say it. Anyway, you get my point.
Yeah.
And so like, so at any point in time, someone can leave or get fired and like for any number of reasons. Mm-hmm. And that can happen because they either find something they want to do more or whatever, but there is kind of a blacklisting in the industry. So like, if he was just like, I want to go do this other thing. Well, happens once, fair enough. It's a good opportunity. Happens more than a few times.
People take notice.
You get especially if you're working for large name artists, they're like, your name gets brought up and it's like, oh wait, the BBO, the bigger, better offer comes along, you're going to go. And like, that's a hard thing for bands and crews and management because they're like, well, we usually want to grow with somebody and have consistency if it's like a good relationship.
Yeah.
And so he had a great relationship with the band, but like, he just was like, he had some like home issues and like, not issues, just more like he had family like sickness that was going on and he had to like be home more. And so, you know, it's hard with a family to do what we do. But yeah, at any point in time, someone would be like, I'm out. Like literally on a show, I've seen someone be like, I'm gone. Like they didn't even do the show. They just left.
Oh boy.
And it was like, that's awkward. And most people will do the show after the show, say, after this weekend, I'm out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So like, usually there's a common courtesy or professional courtesy that happens, depending on what happens. Like, you know, it can be kind of a high intensity gig. We're all tired. We're all waking up early, you know, out late, a lot of stuff to do. You've seen that like a semi truck full of gear. Like, thankfully we have hands, but sometimes that's awful. And like, you know, tensions run high. People need space. We're all on a bus together for hours on end. And so like, I think at any point in time, someone can leave or they can get asked to leave. And like, and being in the monitor position, like where he's at, is a hot seat. So a lot of people burn out quick on that.
It's a very fast paced. I mean, even front of house is a fast paced job, but when monitors, you're moving on the fly all the time. So, if you don't get something right, you know, you might have some choice words said to you, and it's no hard feelings, but you know, they're up there trying to work and you're trying to work as well. So I understand completely what you're talking about when you say it's a hot seat, because it is indeed a hot seat.
Thankfully, I never had any, like, you know, my interactions with the band was never negative. Like, there was definitely growth points and they knew that going in, but I was just like, and I would every night be like, hey guys, how would you feel about your mix? I know you're doing a lot, but was there anything that stuck out? Like, I don't want you to have to worry about it, but I don't know unless you say something. And they're like, yeah, we totally get it. Like, they're like, we're just not like, you know, we usually just let go whatever happens. Yeah. And I'm like, I don't work that way. I always want to be improving on me and improving on your guys' mix, because it's important. You guys need to be inspired by your mix. It's kind of a big thing I say to any artists I work with from front of house or monitors. It's like, you guys need to be inspired because you're inspiring. Like, that's the whole point. You know, it's a thoroughfare for that. And so with these guys, I always had a great interaction with them, and it was, you know, always awesome through there. But yeah, it can be kind of a high intensity bit. And so you got to be ready for it, especially going from me, like same thing every week, nothing crazy or DJing or doing weddings. It was like, this was like explosive, just like, and I had nothing going into it. And the other thing was, and this is something we can talk about, might not have to, but the difference between like fly dates and road dates, like those are, and so we had the very first day we did a road date, and then we had to pack for a fly date. So I didn't even know the initial pack for the road dates. And I had to learn on the fly, oh, wait, but none of that's going in there. What's all going in here? And so because I didn't know where it went initially, when we went back to after the fly day going to the road, it's like, the only thing I needed to know is like, it goes in this Pelican, but it's actually supposed, you know, so there was a lot of confusion on that. And like, it wasn't really set up to be handed off to somebody yet. And thankfully, right. I hope I set it up to be handed off to somebody, like, you know, or at least myself. Like if I were every show, I was handing it off to myself. And that was kind of the concept, was like, how do I walk in here and it just dummy proof? Cause I'm an idiot. Even though I'm working at doing my dream, I'm still dumb. And I'm like, I need to not think about it. It needs to be colored, labeled, wrapped, whatever. And so anyway, I'm kind of rambling, but it's a hot seat for sure in any, no matter where you work.
So kind of one question to follow up another question. The road life, you know, this was your first tour essentially with a major act on a tour bus, I'm assuming.
Right.
How do you compare that to being, you know, at home, where you're going into a studio or something like that? Do you like the road life? Tell us about that. Where you're traveling all the time and.
Yeah. So there's a lot of ins and outs to the industry. And the thing about it is like, there are a few different levels of touring and
my computer's about to die.
Oh, you're good. A few different levels of touring and it's, you know, you have to get used to it. Thankfully, the first gig I stepped into was posh. I mean, tour buses, we got, you know, picked up. I, at that time, was living in Memphis, so I had to drive 3 hours to Nashville to make bus call, which was a part of the agreement. I just said, I live in Memphis. Like, they wanted somebody in Nashville because the last guy was from, like, lived in, like, Kansas. Gotcha. And, like, they've had to fly him in, and it just kind of was, you know, they wanted somebody local. And I said, hey, I'm not local, but I'm only 3 hours away in Memphis, and I can make bus call every time. There's no, you know, I have nothing else. Like, I'm not tied to a house. I'm not tied to family right now. Like, I've got a dog in my roommate's school with watching her, you know? And so it was like I don't know. There was something about it that was like, okay, this is so different. And I had to really change the way I thought about it, especially being like on the road, like, kind of coming from, like, instead of going into a studio or going into the same place of work, it was like, we're in a different city every day, sometimes never getting to go into the city, so we don't really see it, and we're doing the same thing in a different place every day. Mm-hmm. Thankfully, with the posh setup we had, we were doing just weekend warrior stuff. So weekend, if you don't know what that is, it's basically like a Thursday to Sunday schedule, and then you're home for a few days. And that was what we were doing, instead of what some of the industry does, which I've also done, is like, hey, we have a 4 week tour, 5 week tour, and we're gone the whole time in vans and hotels. And most of the people, sometimes if bands don't have families, they'll just stay out the whole time. Mm-hmm. But also when it comes to money and renting and all that stuff, like, it can be better to just come back. But when I've been in Canada for 7 weeks before, basically on the tour bus and like that kind of stuff. And so I like the road life. I enjoy it. I like the difference and changing anomalies and all that kind of stuff. Sometimes it's like the problem solving of it, like when it comes to the work side, I love, because I'm like, even though this is frustrating, how do I make this work? And how do we all function as a team best? And we're out on the road, and our off days are in cool places, and sometimes they're not, but we make it cool. And like, you know, and so I enjoy it. I love the idea of going out 4 days, being home three, though. Like, after a while, I was like, man, this is exhausting, because day one, you're home, you're like, I'm out world, like, I'm chilling for a second.
All right.
And like, day two, you're like, okay, I'm cool, I'm good. And then day three, you know, the impending, like, I'm going to bus call at midnight, so like, I have to plan my day out. And so I enjoyed it. I still enjoy it. I mean, it was a tough thing to get used to, but because I've always felt like kind of a nomad per se, like, it wasn't that big of a deal.
Gotcha.
I just like change for me is really odd, and the way I function with it. And that, you know, goes into a lot of like my history, but like, if you're not used to change, then it can be hard. And if you have a family, it can be really hard, but I like it. I think it's fun and it's enjoyable. And like you really learn how to take care of yourself, to be totally honest, because you're with, you know, a ton of people all at the same time, all the time. And your bunk becomes like your best friend for a lot of people. And so, yeah, I like it. I think it was, I think it's good. And if you're into that kind of thing, if you want an adventure, you want to learn at a fast pace, all that, I think it's so worth it.
Okay. Let's talk about the white elephant in the room, coronavirus.
Oh, gosh.
How has it affected the touring industry, maybe you personally, your friends, your company that you're working for? What's the current situation with that?
Man, coronavirus is the worst. I have my own thoughts and feelings about coronavirus, but you know, I'll leave that to myself and us off air. But like the way it's affected us, like the touring industry got slammed by the coronavirus, and really the whole event industry. I mean, it was crazy to think about. We as an industry bring in like, I don't know what it is, like $31 billion a year or something, or million. I can't remember which one it was.
But billion, with a B. Yes.
Yeah, $31 billion a year. I think GM brings in like four or five billion. That's it. Mm. Like, and that's like, and that's a car industry. Like, it's nuts to think about. And literally, I mean, I think it was almost overnight. Just like,
it just
and
the breaks. Yeah.
Like we were out on a tour and we were, you know, a couple weeks in and it was kind of getting weird, but people were like, nope, nobody's canceling. And like all of the Facebook pages and like the groups and group messages were like, hey, are you guys canceling? Hey, are you? They're like, yeah, we've canceled a little bit, but it seems like the rest of the tour is good. We've got a few here and there weirdness. And some people are trying to get refunds, whatever. But I mean, it was like the way I described it, it was like start of the second or third week. It was like, we're good. Morning of the second day of that second week was like, this is going to get dicey. And like, we've had some cancellations, but we should be good. Like, we're just gonna have to substitute some stuff later. And then it was like evening of that same second day. It was like, hey guys, we got to cancel the whole tour. Like, it was unreal, dude.
Oh.
Like, and so it pretty much everybody I know after that same day, even they had already canceled like a day before or a couple days before, or like that day or the day after, it was like, everybody's down.
Yeah. I know the big one. I know whenever Live Nation said we're done, everybody was done, you know, because they control so many people, you know, and so many shows. And I think that when Live Nation said we're done, a lot of the smaller stuff, you know, they were just kind of taking warning and, you know, doing the same thing.
Yeah. So it's affected us. Like, everybody's out of work, including the bands. People don't think about the bands. Like, yes, they're getting, you know, streams and stuff like that, but like, not the big, like, that's all the big guys. Like,
they're making their money on tours.
Yeah. I mean, that's, if you think about, so like, for the band that I've been out with now, it costs us $18,000 a day to be on tour. And if you think about it, we had 9 weeks of tour. That's 4 days a week for 9 weeks. So you do the math on that.
I'm going to do the math right now.
Roughly 18,000, you know, and that's for three tour buses, a semi truck, you know, the drivers, there's six band members, like
$18,000 per day for 4 days a week, 9 months, $648,000 gone.
I mean, that's for every day we're on the road, it's $18,000. Thankfully, we're home 3 days, so you don't have to do that for, you know, so right. That's where you save the money on some stuff. Like, your rentals for, like, your gear and stuff are still obviously, well, usually, you probably know this, they're usually, like, it's, like, 3 days counts as a week or four days counts as a week, and so you're not really, like, paying for the days you're not using, thankfully. But, like, still, like, all of that stuff, all of that, the vendors, everybody that you just, like, you got to send it all back. I mean, it's just, and it was overnight, man. And thankfully the band, and I bet a lot of other bands are like this, but the band we work with, like I work for, is like, they're like, man, we're going to pay all of the crew for the rest of this weekend and some of the dates that you guys didn't do. It was really only the next 3 or 4 days, but like, at least gave us some cushion for the next few weeks. And so they paid all of the crew and were like, even as a band, we're like willing to sell gear. Like they were just so thoughtful of us because they knew that like they were still going to be making money from like some things, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so there's that for them, but still like they all have families and stuff like that. And so it's still tough for them. And, but man, it's affected everybody I know. Like there's people and like, I think it was like DoorDash and all that other stuff, like, especially in Nashville,
you're
like,
right.
Music City kind of like where everybody's on tour, everybody's a musician, everybody's an engineer, you know, like this, like everybody banded together and there was tons of stuff happening. Like, man, it was wild. So it's been crazy, affected the whole like live event industry period. And I know you feel that weight too, but like, yeah. Man, you know, there's a lot of people that took jobs at places that needed help, like Kroger and Publix and stuff like that. And like, I thankfully have some friends in the production production company industry side of stuff. And like, you would think like, well, those people are down too. Yes. Unless you have clients that do streaming live, like churches and are like, buildings that need data and all that other stuff, because that's
booming right now.
Yeah and so it's like that's what this company is doing. And so we, you know, the joke at the company now that I work for, who's out of Memphis, they're like, well, we've wanted to hire you for a while and it only took a global pandemic to hire Kale. Like that was the joke. And it was like, well, it's kind of true, but like and so like what I'm doing for them is a lot of like it's working from home, but a lot of the getting the quotes done and doing basically like market development and education. So like training. And so I'm doing videos and stuff like that on just like things that be a helpful resource. And there's a ton of videos out there for stuff, but it's really just to like add more resources. I think because I enjoy that piece because like I hate non-informational videos about things that I'm trying to like buy or work with. Yep. And I'm like, I want to do weird stuff like I've got the Behringer wing. It's probably in my background somewhere back here.
But
I wanted to, like, someone's like, oh, it's a 10-inch screen. Well, I was like, give me a relative, like what that, like I can imagine 10, but like put your hand up to it. Like, I want to see how big it is compared to my hand. So when I look at my hand, I'm like, okay, so the buttons are like, you know what I mean? Just stuff, weird stuff like that, that like nobody probably thinks of. They're like, I'll just wait till I get it. But, or use a, you know, draw it out in dimensions on paper, which is fine. But I'm like, but that's what I want to know is like, I want to see, like, cause I'm watching a video, like I want it to be as kind of POV as possible.
Right.
And like, because it's, I don't know, I do weird stuff like that, but that's the kind of stuff I wanted to do is like, I want to get in the nitty gritty of stuff and like also, and not just do the same video. I'm going to do some stuff that's like the same videos, but I'm like, let's cater to as many people as we possibly can in as many ways as we possibly can with people reputable in the industry. So like that's kind of the big thing I'm doing with this company now, that though they're not doing live event stuff because of like coronavirus and stuff, they like are still doing online resources where like I'm meeting up with a friend who has been in the touring world and is, you know, a front of house guy or like a lighting director or something, and I'm like, hey, talk us through your thing. Like, talk us through your setup, you know, because those kind of people are like, oh man, I know the bands they work for. Oh, what are they doing? You know, like I love their show. And so we kind of want to do that, not as like a ploy, but just like, hey, like kind of these conversations, like, how did you do it? How'd you get there? What does it look like? Oh my gosh, that was the first band you worked for. That's nuts. How did that go? You know what I mean? Like, you know, did you ever fall on your face? Absolutely. Like that's so common. And so like, man, coronavirus has just exploded that. And the other side of that question is like, when are we going to start back up? Like,
that's a great like, question.
Like,
that's
are you, question. People are like, hey, are tours happening in the fall? It's like, I think so. Absolutely. Like,
yeah.
You know, we're supposed to be done with the quarantine stuff on April 1st and now it's May 5th or whatever. And like,
Cinco, you know, de Mayo.
Which is nuts. I mean, I'm all for public safety, being healthy. Like, I don't want anybody to die, if I'm being frank. Like, I don't want that. Absolutely not. But there's got to be this. I'm not gonna go too far with this, but there's got to be a balance is all I'm saying. Like, there's got to be something. And I don't claim to at all think it's easy to be in the position that like government's in, or I don't think that's easy. And I probably couldn't stand the pressure either, but it's just like, this is nuts. And like, when are we like, but people who are 1099 contractors and are in the live event industry, it's like, when are we going to do what we'd love to do again? I have a personal theory that a lot of the peeps that are, have families and are kind of older and were like, you know, they, in the back of their head had already had like
be their excuse to
yeah, because of how long it's going to take to come right. back. And they're just like, well, I've had these companies or people that I could work for, real estate or whatever. And they're like, okay, I'm going to do it. I think so. But it's also like, what is it this going to have? Like, what's the effect on the industry? Like, and we were talking about this, a few band guys and I, and like, well, now all the people who could sell out 5,000 cap rooms are going to take the 2,500 cap rooms. So the bands who could on the next tour have sold that out can't get that. Now they're back down to 1,000 cap rooms. Mm-hmm. And like, so the market is just going to be so saturated that now like the really like groups who are just kind of taking off aren't even going to be able to tour.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And like, that sucks because now they're not making, you know, like it just.
It's a pattern.
Unfolding pattern. Process. So I hope that answers your question. I don't know.
Yeah, totally answers my question. All right. So let's get away from the touring stuff and let's just talk about your job as a live sound engineer. So I know I met you as a monitor engineer, but you say you've got some front of house experience and do you have some studio experience as well?
Yeah, it kind of all meshed together at some point, and then I've worked for some studios and stuff like that. So
now a question I get asked all the time is, you know, how do I learn how to do something? So did you go to school? Was it a lot of, you know, hands-on training at churches and different facilities? How does that break off into where you are now?
Yeah, I learned, I mostly am mostly self-taught. I did not go to school for it, though if you have that luxury, I don't know that it's worth it.
It's not worth it, Caleb.
So here's the only reason I stuttered on that is because I don't ever want to put down education.
Sure.
But I don't think going to school for that is for this is helpful. Like, I think maybe auditing a class there on something, because there's like a great producer is going to be there to teach. Like, sure. Totally great with that. But these resources are all so free right now mm-hmm. that there's no point. There's no point.
$50,000, you know, and Wholesale or Blackbird or Crab.
And the
or-
perfect example is that, like, there. This is the way I put it to people. It's like if I have the same amount of audio experience when it comes to years as somebody who went to school. But for the 4 years they were in school learning it on paper, I was doing it on the road.
Yep.
I'm getting the job.
Yep.
I'm getting the job, period. That's it.
You may have met at that concert we did at Harding. You may have met my right-hand man, Blake, who was mixing yes. monitors. And he went to CRAS out in Arizona, the Conservatory of Recording Arts and Sciences, one of the best schools in the nation. And he'll tell you the best way to get a job in this industry is by – getting a job in the industry. It's not, you right. know, it's not necessarily the going the school route. Again, I'm not putting down people that have chosen to go to these schools. But what I tell people, you know, especially that want to get started in production, the best way for you to get started is to find a production house that needs a case pusher and start pushing cases,
man.
You know, and get 10, 15 shows underneath your belt and say, hey, I know how to push cases. What else can I learn? And,
yeah.
And you'd be surprised what you can learn from old road dogs just, you know, doing the job.
Yeah. So that's, I mean, and so for me, I had my friend Justin who kind of taught me a ton of stuff and he's brilliant. And so I asked questions. I was so annoying. I was like, what do you mean by that? Here, let me do it. like, what is this doing when I turn right. this knob and push this fader and, you know, slap the side of it to make it louder or whatever. Like, you know, what am I doing? So I asked a ton of questions. And then I also just used the internet. Like, I Googled and YouTubed everything I could and like got on forums. And like, I think at one point, like paid to be on a forum at one point, just for a point in time, cause I was searching so much stuff.
Yeah.
And like, that's just forward investment. And so like got on Reddit and all just like all the live sound, anything I could, and would just learn and typed in and ask questions. The questioning was huge. And so how I learned something was by asking other people. And then once I got more contacts in the world, I was like, hey, I'm trying to do this thing. Can you help me? Here's a FaceTime call. Well, whatever, like some kind of call, like,
yeah.
Hey, can I shadow you or whatever? And that's the thing that you said that I love is like, I'm young. I'm only 27. I haven't been doing
it. 27?
Yeah, dude.
Wow.
Yeah. I started touring at 25, 26, whatever, and like full time. Like, obviously I could have done it, but like, I don't have a ton of experience, and that's okay. But my knowledge behind it was like helpful, because I'd like touched a lot of stuff when it comes to like gear. And I did that on purpose. I was like, oh, hey, you guys got the Allen and Heath, this and that, or you guys have the, you know, 1176 outboard gear, like whatever it was. And I was like, I want to put my hands on it, use it, see what it does. And so it was like, I was never product like loyal per se. Like, I was like, I'll work on anything with anybody.
You just want one product. Yeah.
Or nothing. I can't tell you how many gigs I did for nothing. And brought my own gear and didn't, you know, like, I know it's not always conducive, but if like, if you can push a case for $15 an hour or less, push a case for like if you really want to do it.
Yep.
And people will see that. That's the other thing is like, and when you're trying to learn, like the biggest thing you could do is be a jerk and like act like you know stuff. That's not impressive to anybody, because somebody's always going to know more than you do.
Through that, especially. I mean,
especially in this industry.
Right. And that's why, like, it's so commendable. Like when you got your first job for King & Country, you told them up front. And that's the best way to do it. You tell them up front, look, this is what I know. And, you know, I'm willing to learn. But if you would have went out and said, yeah, I know everything, and I've got, you know, 10 years of experience, and I've been working on sound consoles, and I know all the terminology and everything, they would have saw through that pretty fast, and you would have been back at home a lot quicker.
Right. Well, and that's other, like, things like terminology were big, because like, I didn't know what a sine cable meant. I didn't know what that meant. Like, and some people still don't, and that's okay. But I was like, I remember asking, I was like, what is sine cable? Like, I understand what a sine wave is, and I know what a cable is. Is it just a cable that pushes audio through it? And they're like, yes, but it's a specific kind, like there's different any of it. And so it was like stuff like that where I was like, man, I learned so much even in the lingo department. And like there's a lot to learn. And I think that like how I learned stuff was literally just asking questions. Like if you broke it all down to whether it was on the internet or other people, it was like I just asked questions to as many people as I could that would have me. And like if someone was like, I remember one time somebody was like, hey, we're going to do this thing and it's, you know, for 2 weeks or whatever, but like, we can feed you. I was like, great, I'm there.
Let's do it. Yeah.
Like I did. I was like, great, I'm there. And so like, I took those opportunities to learn as much as I could. And so if people are trying to learn something, like reach out to guys like you and like, you know, and talk to people that you know, that you trust, that you're like, that, because it's a scary thing to, you know, just as people to be like, I don't know something, because the world we live in is so like, you know, who's the smartest, who's the best, who's the most driven, who's the whatever. And it's like, you know, find somebody that can be a safe place at first to be like, I don't know. And I want to know. It's like the thing that you said that everybody hears is that I want to learn, right? Not that I don't know. Like it's the other side of that. But so many people, because there's been so much like, oh, you don't know, pass, like, you don't know, pat, like resumes and all this other stuff. It's like, dude, that's not how this industry works. Like there is some of that involved. Be aware. Like just because you're a nice guy doesn't mean you're going to get the gig.
Sure.
But I will guarantee you that if you're the one who knows the most in the room, but you're a mega jerk, you won't get the job. Like they will take a young guy or girl who wants to learn, who's nice and can get along with everybody way, like even somebody who knows almost nothing, and take them before they'll take the 10-year pro who just is like way over their own head. It's like, they just, people don't want that. And I totally get why now that I'm here.
Gotcha. Very cool. All right, so going off of topic a little bit, what new piece of gear is Cale excited about? Is there anything out there that you kind of been digging on? I know you got the wing in the background, and I was this close to pulling the plug on one, and then I lost jobs for the foreseeable future. So,
yeah. Sorry.
No, it's I love dogs. Is there anything in particular that you're excited about or looking forward to getting your hands on?
Yes, there is. I will say the Behringer Wing has been one of my new favorite pieces of gear.
Really?
Though I haven't been able to use it, like, obviously in a super live setting, just like poking around on it. I'm like, man, this is a great thing for the market. Now all they need to do is make that like $1,100 market area, whether it's Midas or Behringer.
Right.
But like this thing for $3,000 or whatever you can get it for is like light years ahead of like the X32. And
really? Very cool.
Oh man, it's crazy. So I've loved getting to poke around on this thing. It's so great. I just, a lot of people want to kind of hate on it. And like, I totally get like, wait till you feel like it's more stable. That's totally fine with me. It's stable enough for me right now. I'm not doing anything. And so like, yeah. I can learn it now, but like, I think it's going to pull an X32 and just be flooded in the market for the price and what it can do. And after all the cards and all that other stuff come out, it's like, you've got an internal card. So you've got right. two cards you can put in it. No matter what it is, you can get Dante, the Waves, or whatever, you can do all of it. And like with all of the options and stuff, man, it's like crazy. So I love that. This has been a super awesome like get. Man, what else am I pumped about? There were some things we were talking about. There are some new RCF speakers.
Okay.
New kind of RCF rig that's come out. Kind of like big dogs, like the, I think they've been out for a little bit, but like the HDL 50s and 30s.
As a touring guy, as an engineer on the touring sense who has probably some say in what goes into a rider. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of people like the RCF stuff, but they don't see it. You know, I think that's probably one of the reasons why I went with the JBL rig is because I've never seen an RCF come up on a rider. Mm-hmm. Do you think they're a viable source for touring companies in the near future?
I think so. Yeah, I think that's why I'm excited about it. It's just really, really just to see if it is.
Gotcha.
I know DB Technologies, mm-hmm. not to be confused with D&B.
DB
Technologies has a rig out too. It's called a Vio, Vio rig that is VIO, I think is how you spell it. And it's like so good. And I've used it. That's been on tours, I believe. Like you don't necessarily see them on riders, but when you hand them out and like, guys, this is what it can do and all the processing capabilities, it's honestly like DB Tech and RCF are like a offshoot of each other or something like that, but like yeah. I think DB Tech is a little bit higher up there in quality for me.
Yeah.
So their Vio rig, I'm really pumped about the kind of like the sorry to answer your question, the RCF rig I do think can be viable. I think that right now there's a kind of a weird balance between like they're powered as opposed to passive
mm-hmm.
speakers, and I think people are weird about that. I don't mind the powered setup when you're flying it, like in a, like on a Genie lift or something. I know that I think in the UK and like in Europe and stuff, powered rigs that are like big powered rigs are totally common.
Oh yeah.
There's almost like RCF is massive over there.
Oh yeah.
So is like Turbo Sound and like full line arrays, like 12 boxes aside. Like people are doing powered rigs in the air a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I get it for an install, but like if, you know, I mean, either way, it's just, when you have something that's compatible with what it is
right.
and like made for it and it's a good piece of gear, it's great. So I think the HDL 50s are great. I think that if you're in like the DJ world and you're trying to go line array ish, I think, cause I've worked on JBL VRXs for years.
Right.
And like, unless you have like Crown iTech, you know, amps with it, they really don't sound that great. They're not bad though. Like I can totally work with them. I cut out the 2.5, I cut out the 5, yep. like,
they take you know. Some. They take, and that's what I try to tell people. Because again, I'm a DJ company, but I'm like on the very bottom rung of like getting into production stuff, and it's what I could afford. And you have to work with them, and they don't throw very far.
No.
But if you get the right size room, it's not a bad box.
I totally agree. And outside, it's better because you don't have all the crap like yeah. that's bouncing around in a room. But like, it's got to be a specific setup or you got to know how to work with it. And so I mean, I'm like, for when it comes to JBL, I love the JBL A8s, A12, like all that stuff that they came out with sounds amazing.
Yeah, for real.
And people can crap on JBL all they want, but those rigs are great. Like yeah. I think, didn't they just do like Coachella or something?
Yep, they did.
And
they
so
did.
Like with the A rigs, but even the VTX stuff, the Vertex stuff, when that came, the 4886s and all that other stuff, I thought those were really great too. Like, and then the V rigs and stuff like that. Like I loved all that stuff. And so I think the RCF world might be on the lower side, like as an option, like when it comes to it, like I think you might get your mid-range bands that are doing 1,000 to 2,000, 2,500 cap rooms who could afford it because it's affordable and it'd be reputable with those like HDL50s. Those things are slamming, dude. Oh my gosh. Those things. Oh, those things. 21 inch up.
My goodness.
Oh man.
It's a powerhouse.
Even their dual 18s are crazy, crazy powerful. So, I actually used one for, Josie Dunn. I had they're in this small room. It was like two K8s, like QSC K8s, K10s. And I brought in a dual 18, the 9006 or whatever. And this room fit like maybe 80 people. And I had that thing on and it was just cranked. And I was like, I tried not to overdo it, obviously, but I was like, you know, her music needed a little bit of low end. But I didn't realize how small the room was when I got asked to do it. I was like,
yeah, you come prepared.
I was like, I have a whole 1.5 more sub than I need, like way more. And I'm not just like, I have a little bit more that like helpful for headroom. It's like, no. I could have ran their second room that's like over the bar from me from that room. Like it was crazy. And so like, man, the RCF and DV Tech stuff, I'm really pumped about. I think they're doing
some good. What is, let's see here. We're coming up on an hour. What is Kale's console and or front of house speaker of choice?
Are you a gear guy
or does you perform on whatever's given to you?
I am a both. I'm a gear nerd, mega gear nerd. But if someone's like, hey, we need here's a punt show, here's what we got, I'm like, great. Thankfully, early on in my career, I jumped around on a lot of consoles and I tried to use them and research them, and so I feel comfortable with like changing, you know, consoles all the time. It's a hard question because like I would probably have to break it up even into two, maybe three sections. Cause I think it just depends. Like to have an SC48 for 16 inputs.
Yeah.
Why not? I totally get that. Totally get that. But it's like, I would probably break it up into two sections. And I would put them on different levels. So like my first setup, like if I was doing lower level band, you know, something like that, even B, C band, like I think if depending on the setup, the console of choice for me, man, I think I'd rock an SD9, a Digico SD9, or man, actually that's probably a little bit too much. I'd go with an SC48. Because it's a good console. Or I'd go, if the wing is an option, I'm going to go with that.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, I don't know if that's an option, like, because it's not technically viable because it hasn't been out a lot.
Sure, it's a choice. You can do whatever you want to.
I'd say that, maybe even an Allen and Heath. I'm not huge on Allen and Heath right now, but I would.
Have you had a chance to get your hands on the Avantis stuff?
We just ordered one, the company that I work for, so okay. I'm going to. But nice. No, I've heard it's good, and so I may be an Allen and Heath believer. But I think there's too much hype of Allen and Heath, personally, for what they're delivering. Yeah. And so the options are great, though, depending on what it is. Don't bark right now. for the options, I think it's great. So I know I just gave you a bunch of answers, but I would say if I'm doing like a bigger, like for King and Country, front of house, whatever, I'm most likely going with a Digico, or actually I should have put this in there, but I'll put it in here, or an Avid SXL, Avid SXL 24.
Big
I love those. I mean, just like I said, the SC48, like I really like the new Avid stuff. The 24, the 16, I'd probably go with the big guys, but like depending on the input number, but like, or, you know, scalability, but yeah. I'd say an Avid or a Digico, like the S6 series or like the, probably that, like SD12, whatever.
What about speaker choice? Do you have anything in particular that you really love the musicality of?
I really enjoy the Elacoustics Kara, whatever you want to call it. I really like it. It's given the right system engineer, it's an awesome setup. You know, you've got the SB28s, a rack of them across both sides. Those things paired in 12s, flown at least, like the Kara rigs are really nice. And so I'd probably go with an Elacoustics Kara rig. Or honestly, because I know it, I'd probably go with the JBL A series. I just know it that well. I think I could I could do it well. I mean, I'm a DMB fan as well, like a J-Rig or something like that. So probably any of those, but I would, depending on, you know, cost and budget and all that stuff, but those are three that I would pick from, I think.
Perfect. Man. All right, Kale, we're at an hour and I got a meeting here in about 30 minutes, but this won't be the last time you see Kale. So we have become friends. The world is such a small place now. It only takes a spark. You know, I stepped on that stage at South Dakota and he's like, "Do you make YouTube videos?" And I said, "As a matter of fact, I do." And I thought he was maybe a stagehand or something. But then I look up and he's over there behind the Digico. And I'm like, the front of house or the monitor guy for this major band watches my little rinky-dink YouTube videos.
I've seen them all. I literally have seen them all. I was like, I loved what you're doing, like power and stuff like that.
I appreciate it.
It's one. There's some of the videos I watched just as I was getting into touring. Like really? There were some, like I wanted to know about power and all this because I had to hook it up and all that stuff. And like, well, I mean, that I watched that one a while ago.
Sure.
But there, a lot of the stuff you had when I was freelancing, I was like, I watched a ton of those videos. I've seen all of them, but like,
I appreciate.
They were great resources. That's exactly what I was hoping for. Like some of it, obviously DJ oriented, but still a lot of the same concepts. So.
Yeah. Okay, so in upcoming episodes with Kale, we're probably going to dive a little bit deeper into, you know, setting up a mix for success, whether it be at, you know, the front of house position or the monitor position, what to look for when you're running in-ears or wedges or whatever. This won't be the last time you see Kale, so hopefully we might try to make this a monthly thing, or even, you know, we'll see how long this thing goes. Obviously he's got to get back on the road, but we might try to knock some stuff out, you know, and help you guys out there who are looking to step into production, you know, kind of find some skill that you didn't know prior to getting in. So Kale, I appreciate you. I appreciate you hopping on, man.
Thanks for having me, dude. This was fun. Let's do this again for sure.
Awesome. Kale, where can anyone kind of get in touch with you if they've got a question about touring or, you know, social media, all that stuff? Throw all that out there.
Yeah, obviously you can go the Instagram route. It's just Kale_Conrad. Both of them are spelled with C's. And then I've got a YouTube channel that I have been kind of dark on, but I've been like building up content. So
the video looks super crisp.
Oh, thanks.
Now, what are you shooting with? Sony stuff?
I'm actually shooting with this, if I can grab it, this Canon M50.
Really?
Yeah, that's all it is. And then I've got this, the kit lens, and I got like a Nifty 50, which is like $120. And then
you must be doing like some color grading stuff in there.
I work with a DaVinci Resolve, which is free, unless you want like the big boy stuff, but it does enough for me for free. But so With Rad is what it's called on YouTube. And then obviously
keep your email to yourself, because then you'll get a ton of emails. So if you got a question that you would like, you know, answered on the next time we go live with Kale, be sure to shoot me an email, djwoopig@gmail.com, or leave it in the comment section of the video. And we'll try to get that, going the next time that we're on the internet. But once again, Kale, I appreciate you hopping on and we'll see you again soon.
Awesome. Appreciate you.
Yes, sir. Take care.